student at Concordia International School Hanoi, and I took Dr. Tong's Big Data course as a distance learning course from our sister school, Concordia International School Shanghai. And this course is a project-based class, and in this, as my project, I decided to research about earthquake activities in Japan. So today I'm going to present my project, Earthquake Activities in Japan with Watson Analytics. So why earthquakes? The reason why I decided to research about earthquakes was because I experienced the Great East Japan earthquake in 2011 that happened in Japan. And I think some of you know about this earthquake because of this great tsunami as well as the nuclear disaster that occurred in Fukushima. But at that time, I was living in Tokyo and I experienced cracks on the walls or power outages or like simplified school lunches because the streets were destroyed and they couldn't transfer food. And I was surprised by how one natural disaster can change so many people's lives with many big changes such as tsunami or the nuclear disaster, but also with small changes that I experienced in Japan. And also another thing that was surprising for me in this earthquake was that many professors or experts on TV said that this earthquake and tsunami were unpredictable. And after learning about big data in Dr. Tong's course, I found out that big data is about collecting a lot of data and then making predictions. So I thought, would it be possible to actually predict earthquakes and prove that the experts were wrong, that earthquakes are unpredictable? So the problems with earthquakes in Japan is that it's increasing year by year. And the average number of earthquakes in Japan is about 2,000, but it's increasing every year, as I will show you the graph. So this is the graph of the change in number of earthquakes in Japan over years, and in the past 40 years. And as you can see, in 1976 and like 40 years ago, there weren't that many earthquakes, and the average number was way lower than 2,000. But now, the number of earthquakes each year is always over 2,000. And this is a big problem, that earthquake is causing a lot of problems in Japan and affecting many people's lives. And as I said, earthquake has a big effect on humans. And just in the 21st century, over 19,000 people had passed away, and over 18,000 people got injured, and over 2,000 people are missing, and over 1,460,000 buildings got destroyed just in Japan in the past 17 years. So here I'd like to talk about the cause of earthquakes. So I think many of you know, but the earth is covered by many different small pieces called the tectonic plates. And these tectonic plates are constantly moving. And while they are moving, they often get stuck to each other when pressure builds up in the two plates, as the picture shows. And when the pressure builds up, they can't hold it anymore, they slip. And this energy caused by the slipping is the cause of the earthquake. And as you can see on this map, Japan lies over four different tectonic plates. So earthquakes happen on the border of the tectonic plates. And because Japan is over four different plates, Japan gets a lot of earthquakes. So in my project, I had several measurements for earthquakes. And these three were measurements for earthquakes. The first one is seismic intensity, which scales from 1 to 7, in which 1 is a very small earthquake that most humans cannot feel, and 7 is for great earthquakes. And seismic intensity is the measurement of how much the ground shakes in an earthquake. The Richter scale is a scale that scales from 1 to 10, and this scale measures how much energy was released from the slip of the tectonic plates. And this one also, 2.5 or less, is for earthquakes that are usually not felt, and 8 or greater is for really big earthquakes. And for the Great East Japan earthquake in 2011 that I talked about previously, had a Richter scale of 9.0. And the depth of the earthquake is how deep down the ground the slip occurred between the two tectonic plates. So in this project, I collected data for date and time, location, seismic intensity, Richter scale, and depth from the Japan Meteorological Agency. But in my project, for finding trends, I used seismic intensity instead of Richter scale or depth, because seismic intensity was the simplest measurement, because it only had from 1 to 7, and also it reflected well on the size of the earthquake pretty well. So to collect data and analyze them, I used the Japan Meteorological Agency earthquake database, and I collected data for over 87,000 earthquakes that happened in the past 40 years in Japan. And I used Watson Analytics to analyze my data. So here is how I went to analyze my data. So Japan Meteorological Agency provides this earthquake database in which you can put in the date or the location of the earthquake that you'd like to know about. And then they will give you in the table format, which I put it into Google spreadsheet in order to analyze it with Watson Analytics. And then using Watson Analytics from the Discovery tab, I first used the questions that Watson Analytics posed for me to find any trends in my data. And after finding a few trends in the data set from the questions that they posed, I posed my own questions to better find trends that I really want to find to make further predictions on earthquake activities in Japan. And Watson Analytics was very good to use for my project because I was able to analyze the vast amount of data I had, and they posed pretty good questions for me as a starting point so I could further discover about my data set. So from here, I'm going to talk about my findings in the data I had. So this is the general trend of earthquakes in a year, over 40 years that I've researched. And as you can see, there's more earthquakes in the spring season, especially March and April, as well as the summer season, especially in June, July, and August. And there's also a small increase in October. And these show that us Japanese need to be more prepared for earthquake occurrences in these months, because the data shows that there is generally more earthquakes in these months more than other months in the year. So going specifically, this is the earthquake trend over years 1977 to 1986. And in these years, there's not much clear trend in the data set, that it's pretty scattered around. But as I put it into one horizontal line, there are more earthquakes every 20 to 25 months. And also, I'd like you to look at the vertical axis, that in these years, it only goes up to 800. But as I go on to later years, to recent years, this vertical axis number will increase. So that means that we're getting more and more earthquakes in recent years. So this is the earthquake trend over years in 1987 to 1996. And as I said, the vertical axis goes up to 1,000 now. And here we can see a little bit more clear trend of what we saw in the general trend in the two slides ago, that there's more earthquakes in July, October, as well as March. And here we can see how these months tend to have more earthquakes than other months. And this is the earthquake trend over years from 1997 to 2006. And now there's way more earthquakes. As you can see, it goes up to 10,000. And there's a lot of earthquakes in July, but also there's a small increase in March and October, as you can see. Moving on, this is the most recent 10 years. It's from 2007 to 2016. And there are more earthquakes in March and April, as well as a small increase in June, as well as October. And from all of these data, we can tell that these months are the time of the year that we will need to be prepared for more earthquake occurrences than other months. So here I mapped the earthquake occurrences from my data that I analyzed with Watson Analytics, and then put it into Google Maps to find which location in Japan gets more earthquakes than other places. And this is the map for earthquakes with seismic intensity of 1. And the size of the dots represent the number of earthquakes that happened in each location. And as you can see, there's a lot of earthquakes near Tokyo, as well as the Tohoku area that is circled. And in the next slide, I have the map of the earthquake with all seismic intensity from 1 to 7. And here you can see how that for the locations that have more earthquakes with seismic intensity 1, they also tend to have bigger earthquakes as well. And also we can see that there's a lot of earthquakes happening in Tokyo, which made me predict that there might be a bigger earthquake happening in Tokyo later on, because Tokyo hasn't had a big earthquake for years now. So from these two maps, I draw this power law in earthquakes, that the more smaller earthquakes happen, there is a bigger possibility for a greater earthquake to occur. Because as you could see from the first map I've had, that the locations where they had more earthquakes with seismic intensity 1, which is smaller earthquakes, they tend to have more greater earthquake as well at that location. So I found this parallel relationship between seismic intensity and number of earthquakes, that the more and more you get smaller earthquakes in that location, then there will be a bigger possibility that a greater earthquake will occur in future years that we will need to be careful of. So my question was, is earthquake forecast possible? And I would say yes with more data. Because the number of data that I could use was limited, I couldn't draw like a clear prediction on when or where the next earthquake will occur. But I could find trends between date, intensity, location, and so I think there will be possibilities for a better earthquake forecast in the future with more data. So what I would say, like my next steps for this project, would be first finding relationships between earthquakes and the time of the year, because I said that some particular months have more earthquakes than others. Maybe there could be a possibility of finding relationship with what is occurring in those months as opposed to other months that is causing more earthquakes in those time of the year. And also, prediction of the next great earthquake would be the next step in this project, to find more data and to be able to make an exact prediction on when another earthquake will occur. Thank you.
Any questions? Comments?
Yes. Rio, you've done an outstanding job. It's a very nicely done. Your packaged presentation is very nice. I'm just curious, did you use the professional version of Watson Analytics? And
I used the student account, the student version.
Very good.
What is the trial version?
Oh, okay. Trial version. Okay. Very good. Good job.
We still have time for one more question or comments.
So I have a question on the period that you choose to draw the trend in terms of the year.
Yeah.
You chose a certain period and then another set. What makes you
those slides.
Yeah, I'm referring to this chart.
Yeah.
There's a 1987 to 96. I see that it's a 10-year apart, but
yeah.
Why this? Why not 15? Why not 5? Why not 15?
Well, I think there is kind of like a change in trend in these years. Like the very old years, there weren't much trend, but there were like, they had this consistency of every 20 months they would have more earthquakes. And then, like, later on,
I think what Rio is trying to say is the cycle. Right?
Yeah.
Any other question or comment? Yeah. Okay, if not, let's give a big hand to Rio. Excellent, excellent.